Thank you very much to both the witnesses for very important and enlightening testimony. I would like to start with Mr. Simard, if I could. During COVID, we have certainly seen that there's a predisposition to self-sufficiency and the need for a domestic capability during times of challenge. And you, Mr. Simard, have just effectively outlined why aluminum is critical and perhaps why the United States recently put national security tariffs on aluminum. I'm wondering if you could give us some insight into the impact of those national security tariffs on the aluminum industry.
Thank you for this question. First of all, I must say that those tariffs, due to all the efforts that were undertaken by the Government of Canada and Mrs. Freeland when she was responsible for the file, are now off for Canada. So we're in a tariff-free situation. And basically, the impact of tariffs was mostly on the U.S. side. It's a law of unintended consequences, but economic history has shown that most of the time the impact of tariffs are on the imposing party, which meant that in this case, the U.S. was the most expensive place in the world to buy aluminium.
And so thank you very much. My research, though, shows that there were actually a significant number of manufacturing jobs in the aluminum industry created in the United States as a result of those national security tariffs. So I wonder if that was not a precursor in many ways to showing where the Americans were wanting to go on this. Because while you say that there is that gap between, I think you said, 1 million and possibly the growth to 7 million requirement for it domestically, they're looking to put some of that capability back in the U.S. Would you have a feel for how much of Canada's domestic aluminum requirements are met by Canadian manufacturers?
It's a complex question, although it doesn't sound like it, because it's a complex market. We're primary producers, so we produce from alumina through the electrolysis process, aluminium that is then reprocessed and ends up in cars, planes, and consumer goods. Canada as a country on a yearly basis probably consumes about 700,000 tons of metal, which doesn't mean that that metal is produced in Canada. It's primary metal that is consumed in Canada in terms of reprocessing through the value chain. So
would we have the potential to be self-sufficient in aluminum if we required it?
We're not a market. We're too small. It's all a matter of critical mass. Okay. And that's why we're producing primary metal that we're shipping there where the market is, and that's where it's reprocessed. And the jobs created in the United States are created in the downstream part of the value chain, okay, not as much in the upstream where we are.
Okay. So in this committee, obviously in this study, we're not talking about Buy America writ large. We're talking about in federal infrastructure projects for the most part. So you listed a bunch of other things like aerospace and all those critical things, but those won't necessarily be affected. Do you have a feel for what percentage of the 2.2 million that we export goes to those federal infrastructure projects? So in other words, what is really at risk in terms of that 2.2 million if we're not successful in achieving an exemption?
As mentioned at the beginning, the 2.2 million, because of the demand in the U.S. market and the incapacity structurally for the U.S. to respond to its own domestic demand, the 2.2 million will still go to the U.S. The problem is downstream. So it's Canadian companies using Canadian metal that are pushing the metal to the U.S. to contribute to infrastructure projects or federally sponsored undertakings, that's where the hit will be more so than upstream. The metal will always find its way to the U.S. The problem is the small mom and pop shops that are, that make parts and components that are used in tramway projects or city transit systems that are federally sponsored. That's
so
where
if we'll, we're not
Ms. Salazar, a quick question, 25 seconds, please.
Thanks. So if we're not successful, what is the impact and what's the plan B?
Again, I think success is more important for downstream players than for primary producers. Our metal will still go to the market because the market requires it.